More water flows through a big tube than through a small tube. That is obvious, but how much more? You might think that the water flux is proportional to the area of the tube, and in that case the flux would be proportional to the radius of the tube squared. This is not the case. The flux increases even faster, as you will learn from the law of Poiseuille. In this first video, we'll simplify the continuity equation that expresses mass conservation and the Navier-Stokes equation that expresses momentum conservation. After this simplification, we will have an ODE that we can actually solve analytically. But let us derive this ODE in this video first. We'll look into a tube of length L and radius R, a cylindrical tube. We will denote the flow velocity by vector u, and then we can write the u in cylindrical coordinates. We decompose u in a ur in the r hat direction, a u theta in the theta hat direction, and a u z in the z direction. And in full generality, in general, all these three components will depend on r, theta, z, and t. Same for the other ones. Now we want to find this velocity field u. This velocity field has to satisfy the fit to physical conditions, a mass conservation expressed by the continuity equation. We will make a first simplification and we will take incompressible flow, which means that our continuity equation reduces to divergence of u equals zero. Those densities over here and over there are constant, so they can be taken out. And then we have conservation of momentum, so we will have Navier-Stokes equation over here. With all kinds of derivatives, a viscosity term, a pressure term, and a gravity term. Now, we are going to simplify this, because in full generality we cannot solve this analytically, and even numerically this is very challenging. So what are we going to do? We have our cylindrical tube, and we assume that we have been waiting for a long time, so that we have some steady state. So that means that the temporal derivatives are zero. And then we assume, furthermore, that our velocity is purely in the direction of the tube. So no velocity in the r direction or in the theta direction. So zero radial and swirl components of the velocity. So this ur and this u theta, those are both zero. And then, furthermore, we assume rotational symmetry, so that our flow is rotationally symmetric, so the theta derivatives are also zero. Now, what do we get then if we make those simplifications? First of all, we can plug them into the continuity equation. Well, the ur and the u theta are already zero, so what we are left with is that the duzdz equals zero. That's the remainder of the continuity equation. So what happens to then if we want to plug this in into Navier-Stokes? Well, first let's summarize a bit. What do we have left? We have a u. These two components are already zero, by assumption over here. And our uz does not depend on theta, and also not on on t. That's also an assumption. And the ddz is zero, so we only have an r dependence left. So our u is only in the z direction, only dependent on depending on r. So we denote that, we use a new notation by v of r, where v is a scalar in the z direction. And with this simplification, Navier-Stokes also simplifies a lot. First of all, the temporal derivative cancels out due to the fact that we have something in the z direction only depending on r. This term over here also cancels out, so we have this term left over here. And then what about the gravity? Well, if your tube is in the z direction, you can absorb the gravity into p. And if your tube is not in the if your gravity is not in the z direction, so you have a horizontal tube, then you can neglect gravity. So for now, with slight abuse of notation, we'll just neglect them. This term becomes either you can neglect it or put it in your pressure. So you have these two terms left over here. So that's where you have Arnavius Stokes. And if you plug in your ansatz for your velocity field, you get your Laplacian in cylindrical coordinates. Only one term is left. This term, which looks a bit horrible. And for your pressure, you get the dpdz. And the minuses cancel out. So in the end, your Navier-Stokes equation has reduced, as you see, to an ordinary differential equation for V as function of R.